That's awesome.
Yeah. So I'm blind right now.
But you look good.
We are here in the beautiful Galaxy offices in Montreal in the Old Port, here with Canada's very own Jonas and the Massive Attraction. How are you doing?
Good, Zach. How are you?
I'm very good.
Thanks for having us.
Introduce yourself.
I am Corey, guitar player, Massive Attraction.
The Massive Attraction.
The Massive Attraction, and I'm Jonas, the singer guy.
So I think right off the bat, how did you guys start?
We go back, this is our 18th year actually playing together. We were talking about this the other day.
Romance extraordinaire.
Yeah, that's right. Yes. And it started off in a smoky blues club on Bishop Street in Montreal.
As all of the best things do.
As they do, yeah. And my dad actually scouted out Corey for a side project.
Scary looking guy.
Yes. A beast of a man.
What does he want with me?
Yeah, he's a little bit of an intimidating guy, my old man, but he won over Corey pretty well. They hit it off, and we did too, musically, on stage. And then from there, just started, putting sets together and doing, the odd jam night, and built up a set of the whole thing that we wanted to do is, it was not play all, like, the A-list songs. We kind of wanted to play the flip side songs of, so that... it ends up at the end of the day, people thought they were our songs, so it worked out even better because they'd never heard them before. But we started out as a blues band, and then as the years progressed, nature took its course, and we progressively got a little bit more rocky. And my old man, who was playing harmonica in the band at the time, left the band, and Corey and I just started on this rock and roll trip in 2004. Is when
we started writing songs, and then we realized right away we weren't a blues band anymore. So, I mean, we loved playing the high energy blues that we did, but when we started to write, it was like rock and AC. So like Jonas became a solo artist, so we wrote music for that, and it
which was
took
never
off
really true because I was never we used the name Jonas for the band, but it was never really a solo thing. We definitely have always had this band dynamic.
Solo, you can't hear him.
Solo.
Now I heard through the music industry grapevine, you guys changed the name from Jonas to Jonas from Magical Attraction because this sounds like a joke, but because of the Jonas Brothers.
Well, I think that they definitely had an influence on it.
Primarily Google search term. Yeah.
Well, that had something to do with it. It definitely, got the process moving along a little quicker. But since 2004, when we started this thing and we're using the name Jonas, I was always trying to push for a band name. But the record label we were with previous to this one was more focused on solo artists, and that was kind of their strength. So. We stuck with the Jonas name for two albums, and as soon as we left that label, started our own label, one of the first things was to start getting the band name happening. But no, we definitely I was kind of scared into it at one point because we were waiting on it. We were writing the album for the which is now the first Jonas and the Massive Attraction album, Big Slice. And I was down in California, and the Jonas Brothers had this new campaign, and it passed by on a bus, and it just said Jonas, and I was like, not even brothers, So
stole it right from
yeah,
them.
And
they're just so pretty. What are you gonna do?
So damn pretty, and there's three of them.
I know.
You know, we've been out since June, touring the Live Out Loud album, and most of the time, it's been a real reflective kind of tour because we're going back and playing shows from one show to the next. You never know what it's gonna be like. You know, we have a pretty stripped down crew when we tour in Europe too. So a lot of lugging the gear ourselves and a lot of doing those unexpected gigs. But it's been a blast.
So when you were on tour, is there something you guys need to have with you at all times? Something that's a must on tour for you?
Gold Bond powder.
Not the first band to answer that.
No, Gold Bond is a savior. Teddy bears and whiskey. Do we need to have with us? No, I mean, we're a pretty basic group of guys.
Pretty gypsy-like, actually. Yeah. I mean, you need your comforts to, keep you sane. But, you got to be ready for anything. I mean, we've been to Afghanistan, and it's like you're not allowed to bring everything there. We perform for the troops there. So when you go to Europe, you go, it's like... a few different things that aren't available there that are available here. So you bring a few whatever the suitcase can hold.
Beer there. There's a lot of beer in
so
Europe.
So you didn't bring anything with you?
No, we don't really. Honestly, we bring our instruments, and that's pretty much it. We don't really have a lot of creature comforts.
So the new album, Live Out Loud, really good stuff. So what makes this album special to you? Why should somebody go and run out right now and go and get this album?
This album is... you know, a testament, I think, to the development of this band. This band is always trying to find new sounds and new inspirations in our lyrics and, you know, take a different approach. I never want to write the same album twice. And I think, you know, I think that we succeeded in doing that with this album. It was, you know, as far as lyrically, I think I had more to talk about on this album than I had, you know, in a lot of the other, you know, albums. But previous, those the other albums were great. They were a part of my life. They were more in my 20s. I think that, you know, my mindset was a little bit different. But musically, we spent a lot of time in this album, in the studio, after the songs had been written, because most of the songs are written on acoustic guitar with a vocal, and we just kind of build it up in the studio from there. And we spent a lot of times just going through different sounds, going through like libraries of sounds, and Corey would sit in front of the you know, the board with his guitar, and with Mark Holman and Marty producing, and just go through libraries of different vibes and sounds, and we did the same thing with the drums, we did the same thing with the bass, the same with the vocal mics. Just everything was thought out, and you know, not to say that we didn't leave some things to chance and that there wasn't studio magic happening, but we definitely had a goal set for this album, and you know, when it was done and all wrapped up, we were pretty happy with the end result.
So back to the writing of the album a bit. I mean, this album was written, I mean, Hamburg, some Amsterdam, some Montreal, some Nashville, some Hawaii. What's that whole process like writing your lyrics? Where do you get your inspiration from? What do you like to write about?
Right off the stage, you know, sometimes, and this has kind of been the magic with Corey and I's, you know, bond, is that sometimes we'll be on stage and he'll be in the middle of a solo and he plays something he hasn't played before in the solo, and we look at each other and go, just remember that, you know? And even if it's from a song that we've been playing for 10 years, that sometimes that lick turns itself into a song, inspires something to come out of me, depending also, I mean, when you're touring as much as we're touring, the inspirations change every day. Whether it's because, you know, you're eight guys slammed on a bus and it's, you know, you're running out of gas and you're in a cold, you know, weird North European town, or because, you know, you lucked out and you had a little bit of a luxurious night and you got to have a good steak dinner and you got a little, you know, you feel lucky for a day, whatever it is. Or you go to Afghanistan, you know, like we've done a couple of times. And I mean, needless, you can imagine the kind of inspiration that comes from a trip like that.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely. In your song, Breathing, you guys say, to hold your fear is not to face it. Let go before you waste it. Tell me a bit about what that line means to you guys.
To feel your fear, yeah. To feel your fear is, too close to fear is not to face it. I think that, you know, that song especially really kind of rounds out a little bit of the vibe and the, you know, where I was going lyrically with this album, because I think that it's so easy to get caught up in, you know, the next goal, and got caught up in the next, and searching for the next, you know, best thing or the next comfort, or, you know, and really forgetting that every so often in doing that, you lose yourself and you can lose the momentum, you know, of the spirituality within yourself, the happiness within yourself. And I think sometimes when you're searching for those things constantly, you forget what's going on around you. And, you know, Breathing is really just about taking in the moment.
You guys have the same song that you wrote in French, Respire. So why the choice to have it in both languages, which you did with a few songs on that album?
Yeah, we did it with Breathing and turned it into Respire. We've done it with Tidal Wave, which is now Je Crie Ton Nom. There's several reasons why we did it again, but primarily it had been 10 years solid that I've wanted to write a song in French. We've had, you know, a lot of success here in Quebec. We have a really amazing fan base. This is our most solid fan base in the world, you know, our Quebecois. And the answer to that is, honestly, it's a big part of who I am culturally. I'm a Montrealer. I'm an Anglophone, but a bilingual Anglophone. And for me to you know, want to do that was kind of like second nature. I am in a relationship with a French woman, and her and I speak franglais at home all the time. So to do a song that was bilingual to me, you know, for me was part and parcel to who I am day to day.
I mean, you guys have done some big tours with names like Van Halen, Collective Soul, Deep Purple, Kid Rock. What do you guys take away from sharing stages with such, you know, heavyweights of the stage?
It's pretty crazy. I mean, like, once in a while you get a lucky opportunity to actually join them on stage. When we were opening for Deep Purple, their guitar player, Steve Morse, actually invited me up to play with them. So I was like, oh, this is what?
We heard rumors through the whole week, but we weren't sure it was going to happen. So, you know, we're little kids waiting for, you know, is Corey going to get up and jam with Deep Purple?
It's like, yeah, you got it, man. And I'm like, well, let's wait and see. Let's wait until Friday comes. We'll see if we get it. And sure enough, we got the word that, okay, come on up and you're going to play Smoke on the Water, Smoke on the Water with Deep Purple.
But so you didn't get to play Smoke on the Water, though.
No, the water.
Next show, that'll happen.
We were like little kids in a candy shop. We all had our cameras out, and when Corey walked up on the side of the stage, we were all watching him go up on the side of the stage. We jumped off into the front row, cameras pulled out, and it was great because Steve Morris, you know, I don't know if he thought that Corey was a country licker, you know, I thought maybe he was just a solid rocker. Turns to Corey and starts, you know, there's just a kick going on in the background. Turns around and gives Corey this country lick, and Corey responds with the country lick. They went off for a minute, like back and forth on this country licking back and forth. And then it stopped, and then there was an irreverent feedback, and then gah, 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 and all of us were like,
I'll be Googling that later for sure.
Absolutely,
I'll be Googling that for sure. So again, the new album is Live Out Loud. You can hear it on Galaxy's Top Detente channels and the Rock channels. Thank you so much again for coming
in. Thanks for having us.
Absolute pleasure to have you.
Thanks for getting behind us, man.
You guys gonna play some songs for us?
Yeah, man.
It's beautiful. Thank you so much. Tune in next time. Thanks, guys.